This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The Revolution with Juan McCartney is brought to you in part by Burger King, Bahamas Bus and Truck Company Limited, Wendy's, Fidelity Bank, J.S. Johnson, Commonwealth Bank, BTBI, the Bahamas Technical and Vocational Institution, Insurance Commission of the Bahamas, and Ministry of Finance.
And welcome to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name's Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. All right, today we got a couple things to get through. So first and foremost, let's go through what we learned yesterday at the press conference, in part. All right, but also we want to get through some information about this vaccine because we left off yesterday with a lot of questions, more questions than answers about this vaccine, AstraZeneca, and I'm looking at it, and I don't know that we got a lot of answers yesterday, but I'm able to deduce certain things from the information I was able to get a hold of and the information that health officials disseminated during the press conference. So press conference was, you know, right. We came out knowing a little more than we did before the press conference, but I still don't understand exactly what is happening in terms of contact tracing for Grand Bahama and Abaco in particular. All right, so I still don't have an understanding of that. I do appreciate that the reporters were trying to get at some critical points of information, but I think that that critical point of information was not wrested from health officials, exactly what their contact tracing is revealing in terms of Abaco and Grand Bahama. It seemed to be, I'm going to say, it seemed to be a bit of guesswork, all right? So I have to understand what it is that's happening. We got some people who said that we got some answers about Eleuthera. We didn't get many answers about Abaco. We got some answers about Exuma. But still, we got some better geographical data. But still, I don't understand what is happening. All right? I don't understand what exactly are the trigger points yet for Grand Bahama and Abaco. We see a bit of it with Exuma. A bit of it, they talk about some parts of Abaco in terms of Green Turtle Key and Guanaki. But in terms of the five-fold increase, we didn't get the information that I would have wanted, all right? And that I think would make clearer to us where we target our efforts. Now, before we get into this information about the vaccine data, let's look at where we are. Now, we heard yesterday that, we're trending downward now. Although we had 4 weeks of rising COVID cases, now they say it's kind of sloping off. But again, today, we get this significant number of COVID-19 cases from the Ministry of Health. Now, here's what the Ministry of Health is reporting, and then let's examine the ramifications of it. So the Ministry of Health says that for the 7th of April, which is yesterday, we have gotten 43 positive cases. All right, so 27 on New Providence, 12 on Grand Bahama, 1 on Abaco, 2 on Eleuthera, 1 on the Berry Islands. Newly confirmed cases with history of travel, 3 on Grand Bahama, 1 on the Berry Islands, all right? So you would look at it, and what happens, we find that people travel or people come back from abroad, they get the RT-PCR tests, they're doing the 5-day antigen follow-up on some of the family islands, they get a positive antigen test, and then they have to take the PCR test, and then the PCR test comes back positive. So that's some of the cases that we're seeing. But it doesn't account for all, and it doesn't account for the other cases to say whether or not these people had spread it to these other people. All right? We didn't get that level of data yesterday. So there's 43 new cases. There's no new deaths. There's 280 active cases. There are currently 31 people in total in hospital. 6 of them on Grand Bahama, which is a significant drop-off from Grand Bahama, which is positive. 4 people in ICU on New Providence, all 4 of them in Doctors Hospital ICU. We don't know if these people were admitted with COVID-19 or when they were tested upon admission, the COVID-19 test came back positive. You see what I'm saying? So we don't know if they were admitted for COVID-19 symptoms or if they were admitted for something else. Doctor's hospital tests everyone. I know from personal experience, when you're admitted to the hospital or the emergency room, whatever, they test everyone. And we don't know whether these people were admitted for COVID-19 symptoms or whether they were admitted for something else and the test came back positive. 2 people, so 15 in Doctors Hospital, 4 in ICU, 2 people in the South Beach Acute Care and Referral Center, which is good. That's good. 8 people in Princess Margaret Hospital. All right. So what you want to be very careful of when you're looking at this are the hospitalizations and deaths. So someone in the newsroom was saying, I can sense the lockdown coming, or I can sense the national address coming. I don't think so, for a number of reasons. I don't think that, yes, 43 is a significant number of cases, and if you're developing 43 a day and people are piling up in the hospital and you get to 70, 80 people in the hospital, then you do look at it and you go, okay, this is, in order to slow the rate of transmission, the medical professionals often resort to these lockdowns. I don't agree with them. I think after a year of this, you have to be more surgical, more targeted. You can't keep using this blunt instrument. You're going to end up killing all the other things that go along with a society, all right? So the hospitalizations are not rapidly moving up, so I don't see a lockdown. Deaths are not rapidly going up. I don't see a lockdown. We don't see massive community spread at this point. Don't see a lockdown. So just from whatever vague principles that they say undergird the need for a lockdown, I don't see that occurring. The tone I got from Renward Wells yesterday was that we're okay, right? We're okay, continue to be safe, X, Y, Z, all right? The tone I got from health officials was, you know what? We're not going to say you should be out there campaigning. You probably shouldn't, but we're not going to say drop it. We're not going to raise the red flag. So those are the signals I got from the press conference yesterday. Not, oh, you Bahamians are such stupid idiots. You're all morons. Remember how y'all were falling into that so much? Like, it was your comfort zone. Bahamians are stupid people, and we don't follow rules, and we're all dummies, and only Minnis can save us because Jesus has anointed him to be a doctor at a time like this, whatever garbage y'all were running on with. So I didn't get the sense of that yesterday, right? But I'll say this. For me to see the government or the competent one instituting any more lockdowns, they would have to be putting up tents in Princess Margaret Hospital for people on life support with COVID-19. Like, they'd have to have people, imagine the ward, God forbid, but imagine the wards are full in Princess Margaret Hospital with COVID-19, as it was at one point. Imagine people are in the hallways, okay, on makeshift beds with COVID-19, as it was at one point. Imagine that they've constructed a big tent in the parking lot of Princess Margaret Hospital to house people with COVID-19 as it was at one point. That would have to be the situation for me to even begin to believe that we're going to resort to lockdowns on New Providence. Now, I can't say what they'll do for Grand Bahama, although Grand Bahama seems to be trending down. I can't say what they'll do on Eleuthera, although Eleuthera appears to be trending down. Can't say what they're doing Abaco, although Abaco appears to be trending down. But for New Providence, where the main population center is, no. And here's why. Firstly, you're not going to shut down the economy unless you're in a place of deep crisis. Not again. If you lock down, that means the airports close, the seaports close, no one's going in or out. That means Atlantis reinstitutes its bubble. Bahamar has to reinstitute its bubble, and it might close if it can't get air traffic on the weekends. You are going to have a ripple effect from playing around by lockdown, because I know y'all are so used to it. That is going to be devastating. So I don't see that happening. You would have to be very, very back up against the wall in a drastic, dire situation. The UK variant's happening, that people are dying left, right, and center. Jamaica didn't even, the UK variant's ragging them hard. Jamaica didn't even resort to any widespread lockdowns, all right? I don't see it happening. The impact of that is going to be devastating. You would have restaurant closures again. You have more layoffs again. The assistance level has diminished. NIB's just able to begin to catch its breath. The food assistance program is still needed, but it's not as direly needed as it was. I do not see that happening. You'd have to reinvest millions of dollars to try to keep businesses afloat when you have some semblance of an economy going. And it is foolish, all right, to think that because you see some sort of spike in COVID-19 cases that is manageable, that you go ahead and kill the economy, take the children back out of school after you've crawled your way back, just in order to say lockdown, which I'm not going to lie to you, I don't think that they're as effective as people make them out to be. All right? So I don't see the cause for the harem scarum. My wife was all worried. She's like, oh, I don't, you know, I really, my daughter didn't have to have a birth, didn't get to have a birthday party last year. And, you know, we want to at least have, you know, a cake and be able to get some stuff at home for her this year. You know, and we couldn't do any of that last year. You can't do that again. You know what I mean? So I don't see it happening, not because my daughter's having a birthday soon, but you'll have to go back to, people going to have to reschedule their weddings, because now you can have weddings in churches with capacity. All right. People are going to have to now make alternate funeral arrangements. So think about the impact. Because if y'all thinking, because I know Renwood Wells, he just go, minutes ain't hard to make, don't have a problem making hard decisions. Yeah, we get it. Think about what you're saying, Renwood Wells. Think about what you're saying. I know you're using that as a scare tactic to threaten us into good behavior, right? Which, you know, to your credit, Wells, and even to the PM's credit. To your credit, Wells, you've been trying to use more convincing, more making better arguments as opposed to fair tactics. So if I'm saying to you, listen, I know this sounds like a fair tactic, but let me explain. If you don't regulate your behavior, right? Because you're adults now, right? Even if you're 16, 17, you're gonna have to grow up now. Right? If my 5-year-old can wear a mask and understand you could catch coronavirus XYZ, you could understand it now. If we have this big spike in cases, and it's for the politicians too, what you're campaigning. If you have this big spike in cases, we risk much of the progress that we have made together as a nation. And so let's be more careful in how we conduct ourselves, all right? I am not saying it's your fault. What I'm saying is I'm seeing a spike in cases out of an abundance of caution. Let's be sure we're following the health protocols while I contact trace these puppies and figure out where exactly should we target the quarantining and any sort of measures that we want to implement there? All right? That's the kind of discussion we need to be having as a nation. All right? Now, let's do some text messages. So I don't see it. I don't see lockdown coming. I don't see that. I don't know where y'all at with this. Like, what is that? You know? Is that because you feel like punishing everyone? You feel, look at this. Look at him here. Look at him. Look at this dude here. Enjoying himself. Let's kill that. What are you smiling about? Right? What is that? What you're feeling? You just feel like punishing everybody? That's good for y'all. I heard a lot of that when they were locking people down. That's good for y'all. Is it good for y'all? Is it good for anyone? This says, I won. What is the result status of the senior government official who got a PCR test? After testing positive for an antigen test, the same official was in close contact with the PM and the GG at the Defense Force Base. I couldn't tell you. Is that a rhetorical thing? You just want me to put that out there? That's fine. You expect me to answer that? I don't think so. Juan, I still don't understand the knee-jerk reaction for Eleuthera. Yeah, that didn't make sense for Eleuthera last week to me either, right? In the conference yesterday, they said 42 cases for the year in Eleuthera, 42 cases in 97 days. Doesn't really sound like a spike. Yeah, I mean, that, you know, there's a little bit of activity there. You target that. They send a team down there. I think they handled that correctly in terms of sending a team down there. I wouldn't have done the overnight. Stop, everybody. Okay, look. I'm going to read this, right? And I'm going to ask you to stop sending me this because it's not accurate. Stop it. I'm reading this to you, and you know you're saying it. You're saying, bro, my God, why are there portable toilets at the government clinic in Elizabeth Estates during this COVID-19 pandemic? Who's responsible for these German COVID virus spreaders? The people from the Elizabeth Estates Clinic, and you've heard me say this because you sent this to me. You sent it to me yesterday. You sent it to me last week. The people from the Elizabeth Estates Clinic said that those portable toilets are just there for the people who are waiting outside until it's their time to come inside, okay? If you don't need to use them, then don't. Inside, there are regular sanitization stations. There are regular bathroom facility accommodations. Please stop sending this to me. I'm not going to read anymore out loud, but I don't even like seeing it because I know it's not true, all right? So please. You're distorting the facts. Stop it. I would ask you to do so. We got enough of that going on around here. All right? And the people at Elizabeth Estates Clinic do not appreciate the mischaracterization of the situation. All right. Well, they can't bother with that. No time. The country would die. It's too much because people were freaking out. And why I asked you to stop the mischaracterization is because people legit, after the show last week, they were calling me. They're just saying this WhatsApp's going around about Easter lockdown that they were having for last year. And people are like, no, man, I got to make my money. The people on the fish vendor on the dock, he was like, yeah, this is good. This can be a good season, all right? I can make $1,000 between today and tomorrow. I can get $1,000, right? One of the guys. I think he was just cleaning the fish, actually. I don't even know if he was a fish sales guy, right? And he was like, I can make $1,000. That's $500 a day. $500 tomorrow. This can be $1,000. This is my rent, right? And people were literally in fear that there would be a lockdown and they can't pay their rent. That's what you're doing, right? One day, I'm going to have a show on satellite radio, and I'm going to explain to you in very colorful language how I feel about this sort of thing. What you're doing, and what I think of people who do this, right? Who spread this stuff about the lockdowns, not you with the toilets, you're just, I don't know what's going on, you just need to clear that up, but who spread this stuff about the lockdowns without considering the ramifications of their very nonsensical actions, all right? But since we're not on satellite radio and I can't express it in colorful language, I would just say, grow up, yeah? Let's all grow up, shall we? I know you're looking for attention, right? I get it. You know, I want my wife to rub my head too sometimes, and she's busy with other stuff. But find something else to occupy your time. All right? This says, why wait until people start dying left, right, and center? No, I'm saying it would take that in order to have a lockdown. All right? Because from a purely economics point of view, it wouldn't make sense. All right? You're sending a signal to the entire world as the U.S. says, look, we're having 4th of July, Papa. Right? You're sending signals to the entire world that it ain't safe here and ain't nothing happening and don't come here. As the cruise ships say, yeah, we go home port in the Bahamas. Go lock down talking about COVID-19 spike and see how fast that fades away. Right? Think your way through it now. Think your way through it. As Bahamas Air negotiates with Royal Caribbean for airlift and everything, what happens when you tell the whole place, we got to lock down? Bahamas on lockdown, people. Headline around the world. Oh, I was going vacation in the Bahamas. I thought it was open. I guess not. Let me book my vacation elsewhere. Jamaica's open with much, 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 much more cases. All right. So from an economic standpoint, no. From what healthcare officials say is their benchmark, although they never gave a number, but the trends that indicate a lockdown, no. From the point of view of the political aspect of it, in that you've already gotten up in Parliament and taken credit for all the good that's happened, for all the lockdown, for the masterful leadership and all that, for you now have to come back and suck all that up, for you after you've been campaigning for weeks on end, to have to now go lockdown and try to absolve yourself of any responsibility for any of that? Think about it. No. All right? They're in cabinet thinking, how do we not lock down? How do we not do that? What can we do not to do that? That's what they're thinking. It says, good afternoon, Juan. I don't see a lockdown happening either. The government has just gotten everything moving again and back in some folks' good graces. They're not going to do something as stupid as that. Correct. Right? So you can't talk about your good government. And you know this man is going to call an election here soon. If you haven't figured that out by now. Right? How are you going to call an election? And it's so dire that we got a lockdown. It ain't going to happen. I don't see it happening. I can know what the competent authority would do. Only him, one, and God knows that, I guess. But I don't see it happening at all from a number of points of view. I see that as a last resort if we are in desperate, dire trouble. It says, totally agree, Juan. Can't afford another lockdown right now when our economy is slowly seeing a small bit of economic growth. NIB has carried us long enough. This says, Juan, I hear you on the lockdown not being effective. I don't like them, but imagine if the PM didn't do it with the lockdown. People being defiant. Imagine without the lockdown. I can't imagine. I only know what I live through. I don't. My imagining don't work for me in this situation. I know I live through lockdowns, and they sucked. All right? Now, where if you want to say the lockdowns work, feel free to it, but I ain't going to imagine with you. I lived through it. It was terrible. All right? It says, The government recognizes we really can't afford more increased cases, so I urge us all to follow protocols and behave ourselves for ourselves. Yeah, follow the protocols. I urge you to, too. Absolutely. Absolutely. Even if you see others wilding out, do what you need to do. Right? It says people will die during the lockdown because of the lockdown. These people are crazy. The country trying to move after 1 year and they want to stop it. Unthinkable. No, and I don't think they're doing that. I just hear people going, oh, the lockdown, because that was how we was carrying on before. Right? When you had 20 cases one day, watch me, man, it's going to lock y'all down, y'all trying to be out here without your mask on, you know? So I know the thinking, because you programmed it. You programmed into it. That's how you think, right? Oh, child, the COVID rising. And also, there's the other thing, is that people are getting vaccinated, which we'll talk about in just a second. This is, Iwan, don't you find it strange the power company did not give an excuse of the island-wide blackout during your show yesterday? It wasn't an island-wide blackout. Most of the island was off, though. And they did. They said there's a problem at the Blue Hills plant. So, you know. Hey, Juan, is it mandatory to wear a mask when walking on the streets? Yes, unless you're exercising. So, walk briskly if you don't want to wear a mask. Right? Get them elbows up. Get them knees up. Get them elbows back. Right? But if you're just walking around, like walking from point A to point B, and you ain't exercising and going back to where you came from like so, then yeah, you got to wear a mask. And carry government ID. I don't know why, but that's what you got to do. All right. Let's talk vaccines. Yesterday, we got some disturbing news, okay? So the European Medicines Agency and the UK Health agency. Let me just make sure I'm getting the name right. Have it the UK Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. All right, and the European Medical Agency. Yesterday, both of them separately said that they believe there's a possible link between the AstraZeneca vaccine and blood clots in a certain population. Now, I ain't trying to get no blood clot. All right? That's eight. I ain't trying to get nothing. I ain't trying to get a cold. All right? I ain't trying to get sniffles. I ain't trying to breathe too close up on y'all. None of it. Right? So I'm looking at that and I'm going, "Ooh, boy, let me hear what you're saying." So they said there's a possible link between the AstraZeneca vaccine and blood clots in certain population. Therefore, they are recommending that the UK recommends that people under 30 be offered a different vaccine. All right, and we ain't got no different vaccine in the Bahamas, right? Canada says that those under, I believe, 55, they're not going to give AstraZeneca vaccine. They got options. We don't. UK got options. We don't at the moment. All right, so we have to look at what it is that they're talking about. They say that, yes, there's a possible link between blood clots and the AstraZeneca vaccine, but the benefits outweigh the risks. Therefore, the vaccine still should be administered. As I said, UK won't do it for those under 30. Or UK recommends those under 30 be offered a different one. Canada won't do it for those under, I believe, 55, maybe 55 or 60. I can't remember off the top of my head. Right? And there are certain other countries who won't give the AstraZeneca vaccine to younger populations. And why is that? Because the people who have had blood clots, most of them have been under 60 and most of them have been women. Right? The benefits outweigh the risks. That's just a very broad statement, right, to tell me, okay? So the benefits of a gun ownership outweigh the risk of people being shot dead by gun. I hear you. Yes. People still get shot dead by guns. So let's narrow that down, shall we? So to me, that's a very broad statement. I need you to clarify that, quantify that for me. What are we talking benefit versus risk? So I looked at this issue more closely. The European Medicines Agency says that 32 million doses of AstraZeneca vaccine have already been administered. And they found a total of 86 cases of rare coagulation disorders. So out of 32 million doses, 86 cases of rare coagulation disorders, 18 of those 86 people have died. So out of 32 million doses of AstraZeneca given, 18 people have died. Why do they recommend you take this vaccine? So that you don't get sick, so that you don't die if you catch COVID. COVID-19, one of the effects of COVID-19 is blood clots, fatal blood clots. All right? Among many other things, including it can make you have a limp noodle, right? Even if you're perfectly healthy. 32 million cases. 18 people died, all right? There's still some risk. 18 people died. That's eight. I don't want to be one of the 18, right? Now, who among those 18 people have died? Who are these people who have died, all right? As I said, most of them are women under 60. Some of them had pre-existing blood clot issues. Most of the people were under 30, all right? Who died? 18 of them died now. Now, how many AstraZeneca vaccine doses have been administered in the Bahamas? Over 10,000. I wish we could be more specific than that. All right? But over 10,000 people have been Given the AstraZeneca vaccine in the Bahamas, how many have died after being administered the vaccine? So far, none. Okay? How many have been hospitalized after being administered the AstraZeneca vaccine? So far, according to health officials, none. Right? Now, only people who work in the healthcare sector and the uniformed services up to last week, I believe, and people over 60 were given the vaccine. All right? But we at least have some sample subset in our country to determine that 10,000 people were given the vaccine. None have died. None have been hospitalized. What has happened so far? Okay? So far, 69 people have reported adverse symptoms from taking the vaccine in the Bahamas. 69 out of 10,000, because no one's received two doses yet. We gotta take a break? All right, let's take a break. We'll be back. We'll talk more about it on the other side.
If you love brunch, but it's already time for lunch, Burger King's Farmhouse King has you covered with a burger that's big and tasty. The Farmhouse King features a half pound of flame-grilled beef, a fried egg, bacon, American cheese, crispy onions, and our creamy signature sauce, all on BK's signature toasted sesame seed bun. Complete your meal and make it a combo with fries or onion rings and an ice-cold Pepsi. Fill up for lunch with the Farmhouse King, only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Everyone should experience a brand new car, but not everyone can afford one. Until now, Bahamas Bus and Truck has the answer. The stylish, spacious, feature-rich, yet affordable Mitsubishi Attrage. Priced at $21,900, including a three-year warranty, why not come and experience the value that Mitsubishi has built into the Attrage today? Bahamas Bus and Truck, the country's only authorized Mitsubishi dealer. Telephone 322-1722.
There's only one way to have a better morning.
How?
Start your mornings the best way with our 2 for $6 breakfast sandwiches at Wendy's. For a limited time, choose any two of your favorite breakfast sandwiches, including the fresh crack and sack muffin, honey buttermilk chicken biscuit, double sausage muffin, or the sausage egg and cheese biscuit. Wash it all down with our cold brew shake or coffee. Better mornings always start at Wendy's. Wendy's, different inside and out. Airport locations.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. All right. Now, pardon me. We're talking about vaccination. Now, 10,000 people have received this vaccine, the majority of whom are over the age of 60. 60% of them are over the age of 60. All right. And most of them have been women. All right. Sixty-nine persons have reported what healthcare officials describe as mild symptoms. And some of the people experience more than one symptom. That would be less than 1% of those who have been vaccinated. All right? They didn't record a lot of data about these people's demographics, but 42 of the 69 people who reported experiencing symptoms in the Bahamas were women between the ages of 45 and 54. All right. 25 people reported having headaches. 18 people reported having a fever. 16 people reported chills. 11 people reported muscle pain. 9 people reported pain at the site of the injection. 8 people reported, 6 people reported fatigue. 7 people reported nausea. 24 people reported other symptoms. I don't know what that means. All right. This says the other symptoms, each accounting for less than 5%, included injection site itching and rash, diarrhea, and dizziness. One report of chest pain that went away within a couple of days. No reports of anaphylaxis, which is an allergic reaction. All right? So, 10,000 people vaccinated in the Bahamas. No one's died. No one's been hospitalized. Let me finish my thought before I answer your call. I guess I have been talking a while. 10,000 people reported vaccinated in the Bahamas. No one hospitalized. No one died. 30 million doses administered throughout the European Economic Area. 18 people died. Let's contextualize that when they talk about benefit versus risk. And here's where I am with this. And I'll be happy to take your calls. Just give me 2 moments to finish up my thoughts here. All right? 30 million doses worldwide. 18 people died. Worldwide, 132 million people have contacted COVID-19, according to health officials. Nearly 2.9 million of them have died. So vaccine, 30 million, 18 die. COVID-19, 132 million cases, 2.8 million die. And many, 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 many more have what they call long-haul effects. All right? In the Bahamas, 9,296 cases of COVID-19, 189 people have died. So, let's do our risk-benefit assessment. 10,000 people take the vaccine in the Bahamas, none die. 9,296 people get COVID in the Bahamas, 189 die. So, I do now understand why you say the benefit outweighs the risk. Because if you catch COVID-19, in addition to possibly having a limp noodle for the foreseeable future, you could have serious long-haul effects, and there's a possibility that you could die. All right? I have said to you that I'm not going to be taking the AstraZeneca vaccine. Why? Why, Juan? Why? Are you mad? Are you a conspiracy theorist? Do you think there's a chip in it? There's a bug in it? No. If you must know my personal health decision, that's none of your business, but I will seek to share it with you just for my intents and purposes here to demonstrate, since just you and I are talking, right? I don't believe I need it at this time. Do I want to be vaccinated against COVID-19? Yes. If there's one that I believe is effective and safe that I can use. I don't want to take 2 doses of a vaccine. I want to wait for Johnson & Johnson so I can take 1 dose. I don't believe I am so at risk for COVID-19 and that I am so exposed possibly to COVID-19 that I need to be vaccinated at this time. I am 44 years old. I'll be 45 in a few months. I have some issues with hypertension that are not dire. They're under control. I'm otherwise healthy. I exercise regularly. I watch what I eat. I don't have comorbidities. The biggest factors for getting in serious problems with COVID-19, firstly, is obesity. Next would be comorbidities. All right? I don't fall into those categories, and I am not, and the next category is being older, okay? So I'm not older, I'm not obese, I don't have serious comorbidities, I am not rushing to take an AstraZeneca vaccine right now. You go before me, yes? Age before beauty. Were I over 60 years old? Were I obese? Were I plagued with any serious comorbidities? Diabetes, massive hypertension, have had a stroke, have heart problems, high cholesterol, etc. Were I on the front lines as a police officer, as a healthcare worker, XYZ, and I also had those conditions, and I had the opportunity to take the AstraZeneca vaccine, would I take it? Yes. Yes. But I don't fall into any of those categories, so I don't believe I need to take this vaccine at this time. That is me. That is my personal decision that I have taken that could shift with more information. But I don't believe I need to at this time. You, however, need to make a considered calculation about your personal health. It's none of your business if someone else wants to take a vaccine. It's none of your business if someone doesn't want to take a vaccine who is not you, because it's not your body. You are responsible for you and probably your children. All right? I don't feel I need to take it at this time. If you fall into those categories, I suggest you look closely at taking it. All right? If you are at risk, at high risk for any issues, I suggest you look closely at taking it. All right? That's where I am. I'm not signing up for the AstraZeneca vaccine right now, me personally. I'm not advising you. However, consider your circumstances, consider your health, consider your exposure. Speak with a healthcare professional and move from there. Were I a woman under 60 who has possible blood issues and blood clotting issues or anaphylaxis issues, I would speak very carefully with my doctor about it. All right. Let's go to the phone. You can call me. Call me. It's fine. I mean, if you got something with sense to say, call me. If not, you know, let's just keep it pushing. I mean that. 323-6232. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4316. And 325-4259. 325-4259. All right. Let's do this. This says, trust me, bro. I'm not advocating lockdowns. Hell no. I'm just saying our people need to be responsible. Also, people need to stop making this COVID-19 discussion political. Agreed. Agreed, agreed, agreed. They need to stop making it political. And the politicians should start. So, Juan, you got me laughing. LMAO. Glad I could help. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
How you doing, Juan?
I'm good. How's it going?
Okay, so you made a point. You said obesity, and then you said obesity, and then you said
comorbidities and age.
Can you further explain that for a minute? I want to stay on the phone concerning something.
Sure. A comorbidity would be a chronic condition that you have, such as diabetes, such as, let's say, sickle cell, such as heart failure, all right, chronic heart failure, okay. Such as chronic hypertension, all right? You possibly right. have had a stroke, et cetera. So something that if you have a chronic condition that plagues you, or if you're in a high-risk group, like you're elderly and your immune system is compromised, that's
right.
Those are the risk categories that probably should look very closely at taking the vaccine.
All right, I got you.
Or if you're exposed to the general public on a consistent basis.
So Juan, while you were explaining this, what I get from all this is I feel like most Bahamians who may feel like they're in that category should actually get an examination from a doctor before they even take this COVID test, right?
They should speak to a healthcare professional. That would be my advice, yes.
I'm telling you, and I don't know why the healthcare professionals or the Ministry of Health isn't explaining that to people. Anyway, we're beyond that. But another thing I want to make a statement on, Juan, you made a good point, and I don't know why the Ministry of Health didn't make this point, mm-hmm. that after giving 10,000, that no Bahamians died, okay?
Right.
Very good point, Juan, okay?
Yes.
Now, another thing, Juan, and I want to bring this. This doesn't have much to do with it, but I want to just throw this in real quick, and hopefully you get a show on this, or just speak up about it, because, you know, sometimes we look to you as the speaker of the radio, not the speaker of the house of assembly, okay. Speaker of the radio.
I got you.
Okay?
Sure.
Now, Juan, they tell me that Cable Bahamas is going up on the bills, and I want to drop that right there, because I know we could pick that up another time.
Yeah,
I want you to look into that, because they're saying that Cable Bahamas is going up on bills, and I find that to be grievous because of the times that we're in.
Okay, well, check that out and report back to you at some point.
But Juan, thank you very much. This is an important show, and sometimes in having these information, it lightens people up to realize, because a lot of people are panic and, you know, anxiety over this situation. It lightens people up to realize that they can actually feel safe knowing that this has not killed anybody. And the fact that you said how much you're killed from COVID, well, I say it's better to get the vaccine than not to get it. Thank you, Juan.
All right. Thank you, my brother. All right. I see a lot of text messages. We're going to get to them. We're going to get to your stuff, calls too, after the break.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the Guardian News Network. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's the news at 1 o'clock. It is Thursday, April 8th, 2021. Thank you for tuning in. School students in Roxana Luther are getting sick after consuming what police believe to be marijuana cookies. Police on the island of Eleuthera are investigating a shipment of marijuana-laced cookies. Authorities say they arrived in Rock Sound on a mail boat from New Providence. Several students received and ate these cookies, according to police, and as a result, they all got sick. Last week, a 15-year-old boy who had been arrested for allegedly selling marijuana edibles at school was released on $500 bail. Police arrested the student at S.C. McPherson Junior High School on March 24th, after they allegedly found him with marijuana-infused Rice Krispies treats. Police reported then that seven students at the school were rushed to hospital after they reportedly fell ill after consuming those edibles. That came after police on Grand Bahama and New Providence had recently warned of an increase in marijuana-infused products and packaging similar to legitimate snack brands. 43 new cases of COVID-19 recorded on Wednesday, 27 on New Providence, 12 on Grand Bahama, 2 on Eleuthera and 1 each on Abaco and the Barrie Islands. As COVID cases continue to rise, Chief Medical Officer Dr. Pearl McMillan agrees that political gatherings, like others, should not be happening at this time. Here's Kyle Joaquin.
Be they political, be they a party, be they a gathering of family, you know, we have to continue to follow the public health measures.
McMillan's statement came after repeated questioning from reporters about political events occurring, whether they be walkabouts, meetings, or even constituency headquarter openings. During a time when families are limited to 40 for a funeral, McMillan was pressed on the position taken by the Ministry of Health. And while she tried to shy away from giving a position and said political activity was not being monitored, she did say this.
I think in what I just, the address I just made, I made it very clear. Those types of gatherings should not be occurring. And certainly individuals have, you know, a responsibility to protect themselves. And certainly our recommendations remain the same. There should not be gatherings that are above and beyond what, you know, has been agreed upon and in the emergency orders. As well as, you know, you need to wear your mask.
And in the emergency orders, all social gatherings on New Providence, Abaco, Eleuthera, and Exuma are prohibited. Health officials continue to monitor an increase in COVID-19 cases, particularly in New Providence, where there are 117 active cases, and Grand Bahama, where there are 102.
146 new cases were reported for last week, which was Epi Week 13. Though this appears to be a reduction from the week prior, it should be noted that last week coincided with Easter, when many of the testing centers either closed or had reduced operating hours, and or...
There are 240 active cases in country, with 3 in intensive care at Doctors Hospital. Over 10,000 people have been vaccinated in country thus far.
The Ministry of Health is aware that some Bahamians may have obtained their COVID-19 vaccine in the United States. The Ministry of Health requests that persons who have obtained a vaccine from outside of the Bahamas relay that information to us soonest.
And now the priority list for COVID-19 vaccinations in country has been adjusted. That list now includes teachers and staff of schools, hospitality workers, students, and athletes studying or competing abroad, and the homebound physically disabled. There are also more vaccination centers, including Loyola Hall, Church of God of Prophecy East Street, Kendall Isaacs Gymnasium, as well as Atlantis and Bahamar. But with concern growing once again about the potential of blood clots as a risk associated with the AstraZeneca vaccine, health officials once again saying the benefits far outweigh the risks.
Actually, the chance of getting the blood clot is way less than 0.1%. It's about 0.0065%. And so it's an extremely rare side effect that's possible. And scientists are not really quite clear on what exactly could be causing that at this time. So the overall position is that the benefits for this vaccine do still outweigh the risk of this vaccine.
What health officials also addressed were reports of an overweight man dying on the island of Bimini because he could not fit in the isopod for airlift. We now know that there is a weight restriction of 270 pounds, but that health officials seek to find a way around it.
It's clear that we have to seek to determine the best way for us to be in a better position to manage persons beyond the weight limit of the pods. And certainly all efforts are being put forward to determine exactly how we will do that in the shortest time to prevent us from being in that position again.
Reporting for the Guardian News Network, I'm Kyle Joaquin.
The Bahama Resort offering its employees from directors on down half a day's base pay once they provide adequate proof they have received both doses of the COVID vaccine. The company telling staff it believes business levels will certainly increase if they can advertise to guests that the resort's team is fully vaccinated. Bahamar, like the Atlantis Resort, will begin offering vaccinations to its workers on property, specifically at the Grand Hyatt Convention Center for Bahamar workers, on Friday through April 15th. It's all part of Bahamar's effort to be labeled one of the safest resort destinations in the industry. Grand Bahama Police warning organizers of a Moores Island beach party that their weekend event will be shut down. Police Public Affairs and Communications Officer for Grand Bahama and the Northern Bahamas, Superintendent Teresita Pinder, sending a stern warning. She revealed police found out about the event after spotting a flyer circulating on social media.
The most recent event, named Bad Freaks, is being promoted to occur on April 11th on Moores Island. I hereby offer a warning to all individuals planning to partake in this event that members of the Royal Bahamas Police Force are aware of this beach party. Furthermore, on the mentioned date, police presence will be on Moores Island in full force. Additionally, officers of the Marine Section are scheduled to conduct vigorous patrols off the seas, and we will effectively man all harbors and landing docks in the McLeanstown area and East End.
In recent months, Grand Bahama Police have sent repeated warnings about large events being planned without approval. Grand Bahama has recently seen a surge in cases. In March, 348 COVID cases were reported on that island. Pinder says it's concerning. People will continue to try to break the rules.
It is with great disappointment that I inform the general public that despite the many efforts of officers of the Royal Bahamas Police Force to enforce the COVID-19 protocols, which were implemented to mitigate the spread of the coronavirus, individuals persist in promoting major events that are not sanctioned by the competent authority.
Bahamas Air is negotiating with Royal Caribbean International for bulk rate sales of seats to provide airlift to cruise passengers when it sets sail from the Bahamas in June. RCI announced last month it would begin sailing from its new home port of the Bahamas for the first time beginning June 12th, offering stops in Grand Bahama, its private island, Coco Cay, and Cozumel, Mexico. The decision to make the Bahamas its home port comes as the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention maintains its no-sail order from U.S. ports through to the end of this year, which cruise lines have lamented is killing their industry. Bahamas Air Chairman Tommy Turnquest said it means the Bahamas must ensure it has sufficient airlift to accommodate those passengers who would have to fly into New Providence, where they will board the ships for their cruises. Crystal Cruises also announced its plan to begin sailing an exclusive 7-day all-Bahamas itinerary beginning in July, with the Bahamas as its new home port. Turnquest said Bahamas Air is also hoping to capitalize off of that arrangement. That is the news at 1 o'clock. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Thank you so much for tuning in. Stay tuned for updates on the hour, and have a great hour.
Wait, why you look so mashed up, like clothes at the washer?
No, wait, just a hard day. What?
Hard day? What happened? The breakfast lady ran out of tuna and gritsy.
We need to start joking about everything, you know. This serious, boy. This real serious, boy.
Wait, what's serious? Tell me.
All right, well, today, boss gave his boy one big, big contract. And nobody else get a chance, and nobody say nothing.
Boy, you know that ain't right. You know government contracts ain't supposed to go that way.
Yeah, but nobody's saying nothing. Boss man just tell people to sign the papers. Then he sent me to meet his boy downtown and collect this envelope.
You need to tell somebody. You need to become a whistleblower.
You know I's a real man, but I never blow no whistle. I be drunk all my life in Junkano.
No, boy. A whistleblower is someone who tells people what they see when they see something wrong happening at work.
But I ain't no whistleblower, and I ain't no snitch. I still wait there, you know.
But ain't nobody gonna know it's you. All you gotta do is call Crime Stoppers, or you could text them from inside the Crock Crime Bahamas app. They don't ask about you, and your call goes straight through to Miami, so nobody know who you is. And if you text, your message get mixed up like Kong Salad.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. As a reminder, I'm not going to be here tomorrow. So, Anku Surah, Brother Cleveland Aeneas III, will be here with you to enlighten you. All right. On some Coptic culture. Talk about where we came from, what's going on. All right. Someone did tell me something. They said, Cable Bahamas is seeking to increase fees. All right. I don't know. I'm going to look into it, and we'll get back to that. All right. So I got a wedding to go to, so I'm going to go to my cousin's wedding because we missed enough family things and all this over the past year. And, you know, what are we doing it? What are we even walking through this life for if we can't be with our families and the people we love, you know? Not that I don't love y'all. Well, not like that. Good afternoon. You can call me, 323-6232, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4316, and 325-4259. Text line is 422-4796. So we're talking COVID, we're talking vaccines. You tired talking about it? Yeah, well, I'm tired living it. So when we stop living it, I'll shut up about it. Did they hang up? I thought they were there. I don't know. Call back if you want to. Up to you. I want to try to get the local government thing, too. We'll see. One, they need to lock down these bunch of young people who don't want to work. People always finding excuses for them. At least 70% of them won't work no matter what. Totally useless to society. Okay. I don't know. Are you being fair to them at this juncture? Is there that much work for them to do? Nah. I'll say this. If you got money to potty, then must you could do something productive. Right? You're getting money to potty from somewhere, right? Like, y'all have no deep savings. Somebody giving you money to party? Or you working a little bit and you're partying it out? I don't know. I know you're a party. I'm a party too. I was like y'all too, you know. If you'd hit me with this 20 years ago, I'd be like COVID. And you know what I mean? See all this fine things on here, son? COVID. Ain't stopping no show. That's up, you know, but 22, 23 years ago. All right. You're probably 20. It says, why hasn't the government allowed private medical entities to bring in and administer different vaccines under regulated protocols? Great question. And that's what should happen. See, Renwood Wells said, and he knows. He said that they're looking to do more because he estimates they'll be able to vaccinate about 60,000 people in a few months, right? Within a few months. But that's not going to be enough. That's a fifth of the population, and that's probably a quarter of the eligible population, right? Over 18. So that's not going to be enough. All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hi, Juan. How are you?
I'm good.
That's good. That's good. This is LeVec calling from North Carolina.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going. I normally call Dwight Joe in the morning.
Oh, okay, cool.
And I was supposed to call him the second time to tell him about my experience with the second Pfizer shot. But I couldn't get through him for the last couple of days. Well.
Oh, okay. So you got the first shot. When did you get the first shot?
I can't remember what, I know it was what, 3 weeks after, so I got the second shot on last week, Sunday.
Okay.
So I think it was 3 weeks before that.
So what was your experience with the both doses?
Well, first of all, I go to, my medical, full medical start and everything is with Duke University, medical center. And they had sent out information because I'm a professor at North Carolina Central here.
Excellent.
I think I was in the third group. And they said, hey, you can come in and, you know, you can get the Pfizer. And I already did all my research. I listened to all you guys on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I read all the research. I did all of that. And also I have a former background in nursing.
Excellent.
So I weighed a lot of stuff. And, you know, I listened to the natural, you know, the different natural thing also as well. But I'm diabetic and I'm also hypertensive.
Oh, wow.
So that's the second. I know you just talked about that,
right,
about having comorbidity. So I know I have that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm here in North Carolina where I can't even remember what the amount is now. I know we high. I wear numbers six or seven states, something like that.
Wow, really? I didn't realize that.
I think it's something like that. I know we're high. I just stopped looking at the numbers because I was getting tired. I mean, and you know, I just try to do what I need to do. So I went in. When I went to Duke, I went inside. They greet you outside. They put you, you know, you have to sanitize, all of that, put on masks.
Mm-hmm.
They send you to 1 point. This person puts in your information, and they make sure to put you in a national database.
Because
you have to be in a national database. When they do that, they made an appointment for the second one. And then they gave me my card. Then I went on to the nurse station. They gave you this timer. I went and got the vaccine. She explained to me the risks and all of everything else and gave me the vaccine. And then I sat out. They gave me a timer for 15 minutes to make sure, you know, you don't have no reaction, that sort of thing. So, and then you'll leave. And when I came back for the third time, now somebody told me this for the third time, drink a lot of water.
Third time? You mean second?
I didn't hear you. It's the second time.
Second, right.
Somebody
okay.
told
me. Right. So yeah, bring water.
Told me drink a lot of water. Yeah.
Drink water.
Because the second time, you know, it's just the symptoms are going to be a little more severe. But the first time I only had like, I didn't have anything. It was just like I felt warm that night and that could have been from hot flashes. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
All could have been from, you know, I'm diabetic. So sometimes in the nighttime, if my blood sugar goes either way, high or low, sometimes I feel a little faint, or not faint, but, you know, warm. So it could be either one of that. So I can't say if it was that or not. But what I did before I did the second one, and even before I did the first one, I checked my blood sugar, my A1C, all of those other things. And I also went to the doctor, my care physician, and say, hey, you know, they looked at everything. So are you okay to go? Just make sure you drink a lot of fluids, you know, before you go, while you're there, and after. And that makes sense because if you're not hydrated, you know, the medication would not move along in your system as it should be. And then also even looking at the blood clot, I don't know, it could be, I'm not saying that's what it is, but it's just natural. Even when you take medication, they tell you drink a lot of water. Mm-hmm. So if you go there and don't drink water or are not hydrated, that could be another issue and that sort of thing. So the second time I did, I only feel a coolness to my right side. Like a sort of, I don't know if it's the medication, like just going through the body, but it was like a coolness. And mm-hmm. it just was for 2 minutes or so, whatever. But it wasn't like, you know, long. And I didn't feel anything. You know, but 2 days after, I drank some lobster bisque soup, and I knew I wasn't supposed to drink that. My blood sugar went up. So I thought it was that, you know, but it wasn't that. It was because I drank this lobster bisque soup.
Right. So you had a good experience.
Yeah, so it wasn't bad. It wasn't bad. I know my mom is thinking, oh, she's still on the fence for taking it home. Hi, Mom. How you doing? I know she's not listening, but hey.
She's on the fence for AstraZeneca.
Sorry, I didn't hear you.
She's on the fence about taking AstraZeneca.
You know, yeah, she is. I don't know. You know, when it first came out and I told everybody, hey, because back in February, because I was home in February, I was taking care of my aunt. And so actually I was there from December till February. Mm. And they told me I could have taken it because I'm a clinical mental health counselor as well.
Mm, okay.
And I was in the second group. And my mom was like, don't take it. You know, everybody was on the fence with that. You know, I mean, I was going to take it in any event because I had already made up my mind.
Mm-hmm.
Because I take, like you said, I heard you say this maybe last week, that you take the flu shot and your children and your wife, they take the flu shot.
Yeah.
I do that. From since I came to North Carolina, I had to take the flu shot. Yeah, my Uncle Sam said he's listening.
Right. You got it. They don't give you a choice.
Yeah, I take the flu shot because coming here in North Carolina, it's a different weather. You know, my sister those just left from here, and they're like, this is a whole different weather from being in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm, yes.
So I take the flu shot every year, you know, just to keep that up. And the person's up, their choice. Like I tell people, it's your choice. You decide. You have to do best. I heard how you explain how you do it. I tell people, I explain how I do it. I'm not forcing anybody. I love my mom. I wouldn't even force my mom to take it.
Correct.
She have to make a decision, you know, on her own. Everybody have to make that decision. So that's just how it is. But, you know, it's a choice for you.
Thank you very much for sharing that with us. That's really
interesting.
Yeah,
thank you. I'm sorry, Dwight. I normally come on your show and say my experience, but I can't.
Don't worry about
him.
Dwight. He'll be all right. Yeah. All
bye.
Right. You take care out there. All right. We had another call. Let's go to the call if they're there still. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Revolution.
Okay, Daddy, what's wrong with you?
Hey,
Juan.
Brayman, how's it going?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I am. Something came to my attention. Mm-hmm. I have a question and a comment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here it is. Those people in which insurance contracts speak of natural causes, death by natural causes, mm-hmm. right? If they were to die because of the COVID,
mm-hmm.
Would they get paid? Comment is, right? Now, it's all right to party, but when you're going to kill people and start bleeding out of your nose by doing foolishness, I'm for that. Thank you.
Okay. I'm not sure how to answer your question because I'm not sure if you're saying if you die from the COVID-19 disease or if you die from the COVID-19 vaccine, does your life insurance pay out? I wouldn't know. And maybe it would be determined by your particular policy. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Revolution.
Hey, Juan, how you doing?
I'm good. How's it going?
Hey, thanks, man. I couldn't find it. There is a warning out with the WHO
mm-hmm.
about the hand sanitizers. Did you hear that?
No. What about it?
There is benzene, a cancer-forming agent, in the hand sanitizer, and it's
all of them?
Yes.
Okay.
So they're telling you to careful hand sanitizers on the alcohol.
Okay.
Yeah.
I gotcha. I couldn't speak to it. I don't know exactly what you're talking about, but I'll look into it.
Set it up, and then you can maybe come back to it.
Okay, for sure.
Yeah, man.
Yes. All right.
All right.
Thanks. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Okay. Hello, good afternoon.
Hey, good afternoon, Juan. How you doing?
Hey, what's happening, Anton?
I'm good, man, and good afternoon to the nation. Do you have any idea about the details surrounding the commander of the Royal Bahamas Defense Force contracting COVID-19?
I think he said he had a small gathering or something. I think.
Because he would have been one of those who was inoculated, right?
Yes.
And so I'm trying to understand how long was he inoculated, and has anyone from the medical fraternity, chief medical officer, director of infectious disease, et cetera, explained how is it that he still contracted COVID-19 after being inoculated?
You can contract COVID-19 after being inoculated. That's not in dispute.
I understand it, but there was new research, and Dr. Nikia Forbes also spoke to it on the cuff of the new research being released in the international media, mm-hmm. that for a certain period of time, I think 3 to 6 months, you could expect to be COVID-free safe once you would have been inoculated, after the inoculation would have been so much percentage effective. And so that's why I'm asking you if you have any idea about the details surrounding, and clearly you don't, I guess the media doesn't find that noteworthy, but that's something I think is very important to look into. But also on another note, Juan, as it relates to the vaccinations, one of my biggest concerns with getting vaccinated is the fact that none of these major companies are prepared to assume liability for any of these vaccines that they're producing.
Right.
That within itself says to you that clearly they have no idea of the level of safety, although they are touting that these vaccines are safe. If they are so safe, why aren't they prepared to put their money where their mouth is, where they can be hurt in terms of real safety and being held accountable for the medication that they're producing and accept liability?
Now,
right?
Did you share these concerns with Philip Brave Davis and Chester Cooper, both of whom have been vaccinated?
Absolutely. One, as a matter of fact, and I would end on this note, which would have been going to, not directly to them, but ending in that same vein. However, on the flip side, for me, the only way I would upfront just completely decide to go and take the vaccine is if I have some kind of a need for travel, or if there is an absolute requirement by some entity that I have to do business with, or whatever the case may be. For both men, which they both fall in those categories, right? Okay. But for me personally, one, that's a major concern. And regardless of whether I'm forced to take the vaccine because I have to conduct business in country or outside of country based on the entity or the location of the entity, that's still a legitimate and major concern, one, at the end of the day.
Okay.
Anyway, thank you for the opportunity.
All right. So firstly, maybe you heard something as of this morning that I have not heard about any of these vaccines preventing you from catching COVID-19. Because everything I have ever read about the vaccines does not speak to you being able to not catch COVID-19. What they are designed to do is to reduce the likelihood that you will have severe symptoms or die from COVID-19. That is what they are for. They are not meant to stop you from catching COVID-19, and they are not meant to stop you from transmitting COVID-19 at any point. So I don't know what you're speaking to or what Dr. Nikia Forbes is speaking to, that you can't catch COVID if you take a vaccine. That's not what it's for. You can catch COVID if you get vaccinated. If you get both doses of these vaccines or any vaccine, you can catch COVID, okay? The point is to make it less likely that you get very sick from COVID-19, just like the flu vaccine. Doesn't mean you don't catch the flu. I'm immune to the flu now. I'm superhuman. No, it means it's supposed to help you have mounted already an immune response to the flu, so that if you do catch the flu, your body knows how to fight it already. Let's not confuse this issue, okay? It is not meant to make you unable to catch COVID-19. Let's walk all along with the same set of facts. Again, maybe some research paper you read that was published today, since I was still doing research on this up to last night, says something different. But that's not what the vaccines are designed to do. As far as liability, that's pretty standard across the board. All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Yes. Hello.
Yeah, hey, Juan, what's good?
But what's up, buddy?
Yeah, good. So listen, I mean, you know, so many, I mean, I don't even know how to start it by saying it's a wonder to me. I'll put it in. It's a wonder and amazing to me that from the break of the gate, from the outset of the vaccine coming into the Bahamas, it was already established, already said, it is a voluntary decision.
Right.
No gun to your head, no knife to your throat. If you want to take it, take it. If you don't, you don't. I heard you say, you know what? I'm not taking it just yet. I'm going to wait it out. That's what I'm doing, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So the thing is, I don't understand from the political side of everything. When you see political leaders taking these vaccines, I don't know if they made the decision based on their age or maybe, you know, it's a form of encouraging persons that follow them.
Well, let me hold on there for me, Shay. Listen, Brave Davis had COVID-19, was hospitalized with COVID-19, both here and the United States. You ain't got to tell him to go take no vaccine. You ain't got to convince him. He knows what it can do.
Right. But see, here's the thing. I had it for 12 days. I can tell you, even with that, I still am, like you, on the fence for taking the vaccine. I'm like, I'm going to wait till further notice. And isn't the vaccine, can we say, is it still not in its trial or in its infancy stage?
It's still in the clinical trial stage. It's been approved for emergency use because they found it to be effective, and so they say safe. So, you know,
right. That's what... So you and I are not paranoid by or acting paranoid based on scientific facts that vaccines sometimes take somewhere between 3 to 5 years to become totally approved for use outright.
Right.
Correct?
Correct. Yes, absolutely.
Right. So this is just a trial. So technically, there's like a lot of guinea pigs running around.
Yeah, I mean, it's in its trial phase, so.
Yeah, so, yeah. You know, I think it's disingenuous for anyone on any political side to try to politicize it for fair people, because if it's going to work, it's going to work. Be it Pfizer, be it Astra, be it Johnson & Johnson, whatever. If it's going to work, it's going to work. And, you know, I'm a person, I feel as if everybody is different, one. Everybody's body's going to react differently. Unfortunately, some people may die because of the vaccine, but we're being told the benefits outweigh the risk.
Right, you got to weigh it out.
And if you ask the science, put it on a scale for me. Is it like 90-10? Is it like 70-30? Whatever the weight is, they're still saying it still is outweighed by risk versus the reason to take it. So, you know, I mean, I would. This is what I would say. I would encourage anybody once take the vaccine in your own good conscience, just take it. Don't let no spiritual leader, political leader, or my mother's 81. I told my mother, Mommy, do not take that vaccine just yet.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Thank God she's not been exposed to it. But my thing is, I have a level of fear and a level of concern, but I also have a level of optimism that it, you know what I mean? But I'm still weighing it out.
And that's fine, and you do that, and you make your thanks for calling. You make your decisions. I'll be real with you. If my mother were alive today, I would encourage her to take the vaccine. All right, and I mean that. I would encourage her because my mother had numerous comorbidities, which she had issues that killed her. Right, and I would not want to see COVID-19 on top of that. So, were my mother alive, I would drive her there. Okay. To go get the vaccine. And that's just me. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Mr. McCartney. How are you doing, sir?
I'm good. How's it going?
Great. Mr. McCartney, when the emergency order is over?
Supposedly May 30th or something like that. Yeah.
Okay. I could see them trying to get these numbers up to slide that back in there again.
I mean, what? I don't think they're going to... I think they're going to extend it, particularly if there's no election. Yeah.
I tell everybody that's all. These numbers going up because this man trying to extend that for real, though.
Yeah, well, you don't need numbers to go up to extend it. You just go do it. Yeah.
Well, he'll have a kickback. People will be fighting back, though.
Right, but it don't matter because people have been pushed back before. Now, the only... Oh, someone says May 23rd. The only issue you have is if the people, the members of Parliament will go for it.
And
that's
you
it.
Know they can go for that.
Of course,
they do,
yeah.
They tell him to.
Of course.
If he tell them, let's go do this. If you all don't do this, you all know what I can do. I can call the election.
Right.
The gravy over. That's it.
Right. They're going to do whatever he says. They just hand over the power, and that's what it is. So it ain't us. The only way to do it is to, again, have an election.
Okay, Ms. McCartney.
All right.
Thanks.
Which, you know, I'm ready. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How's it going?
My brother?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, man. I'm fine. I think what Anton was mentioning is about it doesn't stop you from transmitting it completely or getting it, but it reduces the chances of doing so.
I think. I haven't heard reduces the chances of getting it. I heard it. They've found some evidence that the transmissibility is reduced.
So,
When it comes to the commodore
of the Defense Force, right? It also is a two week period, whereas before the jump start the immune system takes place. So if we came in contact with someone that had it, even prior. You know, prior to that 2 week period, he has a larger chance of catching it.
But he may have caught it before he got vaccinated. So I don't know.
And then the other thing about the blood clot is that, it's been blocked from the onset when the information first started coming out in January. They said it's possible there was a link between AstraZeneca and these blood clots.
Right.
But the percentage in regards for you being at risk for this blood clot is less than the percentage of women being at risk from blood clots due to birth control.
Right, exactly. Right, yes.
Right. So I understand the concern. I understand why anyone should be concerned about, you know, blood clots when it comes to these vaccines. But have you have any reports? Have you ever heard any reports from the wider Caribbean who have rolled out their vaccination program to doctors in a couple months before?
I haven't heard any major issues, no. Nope.
All right.
I haven't. Yeah.
I'll hang up and listen.
Okay, for sure. Thanks. That doesn't mean there aren't any. You know, you can't make these things let you panic. You know what I mean? Like, they tell me you're not supposed to take Advil after you've had more than 3 alcoholic beverages. But, you know, your liver's going to fail. Well, let's find out. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan. How are you?
I'm well. How are you?
Juan, just like yourself, I was waiting on the Johnson & Johnson vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
But I watch Channel 10 News every morning at 5 a.m. Mm-hmm. And this morning they said that the Johnson vaccine, mm-hmm. They held up on giving it to people because that now is showing some side effects and stuff to people who took it.
Mm-hmm.
So they stop doing it for now until they find out some further stuff about it.
Okay. Who stopped
doing
it?
That's what I called you to tell you. I was waiting on the Johnson & Johnson too.
Mm.
So it seems like all these right now are giving people, you know, little side effects and stuff.
Yeah, I saw some adverse side effects with Johnson & Johnson. They said they did it out of an abundance of caution. Like I say, I have the COVAX facility said they anticipate they wouldn't be able to get Johnson & Johnson until July. So we have time to figure this thing out, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Because I saw where they said they had closed a couple of sites because people, under fewer than 1% of people, had showed some sort of reaction. But I don't understand what those reactions are. All right? I've heard skin reactions, right? I've heard some anaphylactic reactions. I don't know for sure yet. But I'm prepared at this point from what I've read so far. We'll see how it goes with the administration and what the data reveals and the real-world experience reveals. But I'm prepared so far. All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. McCartney.
Hey, how are you doing, buddy?
Yeah, so much to start from. I'm so confused. You know, Mr. McCartney, there's so much disinformation out there. But even, it's unbelievable. But I'd like to thank you, like you say, the guy who called you to speak up the radio. I like you for disclosing the fact that COVID-19 was ever linked to blood clots from the cytokine storm, right?
Yeah.
Right, and deep vein thrombosis. So I don't know why the pundits are pondering about this particular side effect, right? This is making me sick. You know, the other certain websites and certain companies are putting out people who shouldn't be vaccinated, right?
Uh-huh.
And so, you know, pregnancy women, people with comorbidities, immune compromise, allergies, and also women who periods are on. Who go into periods are on should be vaccinated all because of the prostaglandins. People should just go and read that because of the way how the immune system responds to the prostaglandins control blood clots, inflammation, and it goes where it's needed. But what I'm saying is you cannot see. I was following up stuff from like the 90s. So the medical pundits are laughing at us trying to make sense of this. What happens is now the scientific community has been moving away from live and attenuated vaccines into subunits, recombinants, right, for vaccinations. And so because of this, the immune response has been lessened. And so this is now why they study adjuvants. They was using alums in adjuvant, compounds of alum for years, maybe about 70 years, and that's the only lysine adjuvant. And so what happens is, in order for you to make sense of this, I respect you because I see you disclose the messed up botch of vaccines from one of the companies also, right?
Yeah.
But I see they're not disclosing the fact that the Wuhan Institute of Virology is not being fought with the World Health Organization. All of these things, the public are being held from so much. But anyhow, adjuvants, they are adjuvants for immune response, and adjuvants are known to cause leukocytes and cytokines and chemokines and prostaglandins as biomarkers. They produce this inflammation, hence the blood clot. So I don't know why they're pounding on that. But the scientists have been moving away from those vaccines, and these vaccines require adjuvants. So do me a favor. I don't want to run on too long because it's sickening to me. I want you to go and investigate and read this. This is on Google because some people think Google is the only search engine. Emerging concepts in the science of vaccine adjuvants, all right?
Okay.
Adjuvants is a whole topic altogether, all right? We'll be being duped, you know. But the thing is, the people who are not wanting a vaccine, they are embarrassing us. So we are being coerced. And the vaccine is mandatory because the paradigm that they're going to create, it is mandatory.
Okay, my brother. You know, I think people are incentivizing people to take the vaccine. No one's like, you know, forcing you to take the vaccine. All right, but we're going to do the text messages. All right, so give me a break on the phone calls for now. This says, good afternoon. One, the majority of them were female. Two, like me, they'll be all right. We need more info on the demographics, race, etc. With blood clots, yeah. This says, with any good day, Juan, Dr. Seymour again, as a doctor of over 17 years who's dealt with well over 1,000 patients, I'm speaking up and letting you know that with any disease or virus, if not isolated and tested, it's not real. If I use an inaccurate test and then proceed to give you an experimental treatment for SARS-CoV-2, the death rate is less than 1%. How is this a pandemic? This is why I was fired. I'm not sure I'm clear on that. Maybe that's me. It says, imagine getting a vaccine for a 99.9% survivable virus and you end up dying because of it. Might as well take your chances without it. Look up MSNBC contributor Midwin Charles. She took the vaccine and died 3 weeks later. I saw she died. I don't know that it's just related to the vaccine. It says, I've heard a health professional say they can't really tell if the vaccine killed you, so vaccine deaths may just be counted as COVID deaths. Who knows? Yeah, I mean, again, we didn't got to go back and forth. I showed you the numbers there as to how many people died who caught COVID-19 and how many people died who were vaccinated with AstraZeneca from blood clots. And it's just, so I just am saying I understand why they say the benefit outweighs the risk if you're, you know, someone who should probably be protected against COVID-19. So they got mine today at Loyola Hall. Process was seamless and very organized. Great. Says most Bahamian men would prefer death over a limp noodle. Yeah, you're right. Everyone is focused on present effects of the vaccine. What about effects weeks, months, and years from now? What if all sorts of things start going wrong with millions who've taken the vaccine? Yep, it's possible. What if all sorts of things go wrong with millions who've gotten COVID? Which they're finding that that is the case. They're long-haul effects. All right. This says, good afternoon, Juan. Well, my 73-year-old mom got it, and I feel like the only effect she had was energy, LOL. She was jamming. It was an organized process, and I was very impressed. Again, I would ask my mother to take the vaccine were she alive today, all right? And I would take her to go get it. Now, you do what you want with your body and your mom or whatever like that. That's on you, all right? Juan, the main reason for taking the vaccine is not for you, but to protect others. You travel about and come into contact with many people, so you should be taken to protect your fellow man for the overall well-being of the society. Nah, I know about that. If that's the reason to take the vaccine, but ain't that a reason they should take the vaccine? Not me. Because the vaccine will stop you from transmitting it. I mean, there's some evidence so far that maybe it reduces the chance, but they still ask people who are vaccinated to wear the mask to protect people, right? So if you feel as though you are going to have an issue with COVID-19, that argument doesn't make sense to me that you just made, but no disrespect. If you feel as though you are going to be impacted by COVID-19, then you should take the vaccine. That's the way I look at it. Suppose your doctor lies to you and encourages you to take the vaccine. I mean, I suppose, you know, turtles grow wings. I don't know. But suppose your doctor lies. I can't tell you. What if your doctor lied to you? Suppose she told you she was on birth control. Suppose. You know what I mean? We could do that all day. Hey, Juan, though I concur that the air of concern is warranted in regards to the blood clots linked to the vaccine, we must still remember that there's a greater percentage chance of getting blood clots through birth control than this vaccine. Yeah, true. Also, have there been any reports in the wider Caribbean regards to blood clots from this vaccine? I haven't heard any. It says, Juan, getting my nerd on for a second. If a COVID death for many countries is any death within 28 days of a positive COVID test, statistically, we then should count any death within 28 days of a vaccine as a vaccine death? Just saying. They said the president. I mean, look, I'm counting them, right? So the blood clots, the 18, I'm putting that on AstraZeneca, right? So I know it doesn't seem fair, but I'm going 18 people who took the AstraZeneca vaccine died, right? 189 people who caught COVID-19 died, right? So dad is dead, and we're seeing some sort of link there. So I'm not saying that there's no way that these people died because they took AstraZeneca. What I'm saying is that if you look at the numbers, the people who got COVID-19 died at a much, 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 much greater rate than people who got administered AstraZeneca. All right? We got to take a break. We'll be back on the other side.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Are you tired of that boring 9-to-5? Do you need a new and exciting career? Visit the Bahamas Technical and Vocational Institute, where your passion can become your profession. Let us introduce you to a career in information technology, cosmetology, construction, office administration, auto mechanics, electronics, and more. Say goodbye to that 9-to-5 and hello to the possibilities. Call us today at 502-6338. Apply by November 16, 2020.
After a hurricane, you may experience loss or damage to your property. The Insurance Commission of the Bahamas would like to advise that if your property is insured, try to minimize your loss. Contact your agent or insurer right away. Know what you are covered for under your policy. Note that after a hurricane, insurers hire loss adjusters to assist with speedy settlement of claims. For more information on what to expect when making a hurricane claim, visit www.icb.gov.bs.
Have an outstanding real property tax bill? Take advantage of our real property tax forgiveness program. Bring your account to zero and receive a 50% discount on your outstanding tax and surcharge past 180 days. Or get a payment plan. Make a 25% deposit on your outstanding tax, receive a 100% waiver on the surcharge, and pay the difference within 36 months, interest-free. Contact the Department of Inland Revenue at 225-5778 or email us at rptforgive@bahamas.gov.bs. Offer ends May 31st.
At Bahamas Bus and Truck Company Limited, we provide vehicles known for quality and durability. From the iconic Jeep Wrangler to the award-winning Grand Cherokee, we've got your everyday driver covered. For larger tasks, our Ram 1500, Mitsubishi Fuso Canta trucks, CMC Verica vans, and Fuso Rosa jitneys do way more than just deliver. We even carry a wide variety of pre-owned vehicles. To keep you going, our parts, service department, and body shop can accommodate our brands and others. Call us today at 322-1722 or email info@bahamasbus.com.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. I can't think of any more calls. I'm going to deal with your text messages. It says, what is this? Hey, Juan, you talk about your mother's death a lot. It sounds like you're still grieving. Okay. Okay, I don't know where you're coming from with that, but I don't know if your mother has died and how you process that, but my mother died 6 months ago after spending 6 months nearly dying in my house, and so, yes, I am still grieving my mother's death. I do so daily, almost hourly. I do so as I dream often and as I wake. So I don't know what you're trying to get at. Maybe you're trying to express sympathy, and I will take it like that and say thank you. Hi, let's see if the political parties will follow the medical professionals. Okay. Well, McMillan said they shouldn't be having these sorts of events. Nothing. She was like, you see, Melly McMillan was walking that line so tenderly. She was like, y'all ain't gonna wrap me up today, right? Y'all ain't gonna cost me this good government job, I. She's like, all of it, right? Whether it's political or gambling or family, all of it, all right? It says, good day, Juan. Can we agree to disagree? Okay. I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but a realist. The AstraZeneca vaccine has not been approved by the FDA, correct? Nope, not yet. The FDA is who we've been trusting for decades, but somehow it's been administered to millions of people. Do you know that people are investing in these vaccines getting rich? Yeah, they sure are. And these people know very well that this vaccine is meant to depopulate. Look at who's being affected. Black mothers. That vaccine also affects your reproductive organs. I ask again for your kids' future. Examine the big picture more closely. The vaccine with the chip in it has not been released to the public as yet, only to the elite for now. All right? Yes, we'll disagree on that. It says, I turned my radio on to 104.5 yesterday afternoon. This man said conversation 8 times in 2 minutes. Does Howard have a show on 104.5? Yes, he does. Yeah, that's my brother, Howard. All right. He wants to have a conversation. I don't know what the problem is. Hi, Juan. I took the Johnson & Johnson vaccine last Saturday. Side effects were minimal. Nosebleed, arm soreness, fatigue. Nosebleed is minimal? I'd be worried if my nosebleed. I get nosebleeds. So, yeah. I used to have it a long time. Don't want to jinx it. My boyfriend took the first shot of Moderna. He had slight fever and fatigue. My mom took the first dose of Pfizer, said no side effects at all. The nurse in America said she understood why we didn't want AstraZeneca. And you just might not want it. The government has it available if you want it, right? Renwood Wells asked people who were vaccinated outside of the country to come back and let them know that they were vaccinated, right? Which is fine. He said that they're looking at getting some Johnson & Johnson. We're seeing some adverse reactions. Some. All right. In the United States, as that rollout progresses. All right. So we'll see how it goes. He said that they're going to get the freezers soon. The government will have freezers soon to store Pfizer and Moderna. We got Novavax that's coming up. We got private facilities now, Renwood Wells indicated, that have freezers to store Pfizer and Moderna. All right. It says it's a lie that there's a COVID-free window after taking the vaccine. Yeah, I've never heard that at all. It says, Juan, it's not even about the commander catching COVID. He probably only had the first dose when he got sick. Secondly, who's to say that COVID was not already in his system when he received the first dose? Exactly. The experts have made it clear that the vaccine does not kill the virus, so if it was already in his system when he was vaccinated, the vaccine would be of no use. Right. You can still catch COVID if you take the vaccine. That's the whole point of this, is to teach your body to mount an immune response if you do catch it. That's the entire point the entire time. It says nosebleed is minimal. Yeah, I don't know. I'd be worried if I had nosebleed. Every time I got nosebleeds, I stop. I go, oh, my nosebleed. Let's just keep on going. It says, Juan, don't quote Anton as his facts are laced in PLP foolishness. I never heard Nikia Forbes say that. I didn't hear her say that either. Juan, 180 hand sanitizers were tested by a lab, and about 20 were found to have a high benzene level. Benzene was permitted as part of the alcohol process in petroleum base used beginning pandemic. Most use plant-based alcohol presently. Bad interpretation of the video to person watch. Oh, okay. I see. I haven't read that. And thank you for sharing that with me. I don't have access to all the information all the time. Avatar 1, if the vaccine only stops one from getting severe symptoms, this is pointless because of the rate of hospitalizations, of severe hospitalizations, and also death is so low. Yeah. I mean, the rate is low, yes, but I don't know that you don't need to vaccinate people because it's low at the moment. I think you want to vaccinate people in order to keep it low. Juan, you never had COVID-19. You never took no foolishness home. So what the text was trying to implicate was totally contrary to the fact that the Lord keeps us in the Bahamas. The vaccine is good for anyone who's truly sick. Yeah. Juan, you're assuming that you can trust the vaccine death data. I mean, I can only go off what they say. You know what I mean? That's all. I can only go off what they say. I'm just telling you what their data is. It says, nosebleed is minimal, man. What are we dealing with now? Yeah, I grew a third eye. Minimal side effect. Yeah, but I've had the blood nosebleed would worry me. Okay. Why the lengthy discussion by parties on whether they take the COVID-19 vaccine or not? It really distills down to an informed personal choice, weighing all the personal risk. Let's stop majoring minor stuff. We have too many holes in Her Majesty's Bahamas to get distracted. Yeah, I mean, it is your personal choice. Said, who is that idiot? My mother died in 2019 and I'm still grieving. Wow. So, I mean, I don't know. If you think you're listening to some sort of AI program on the radio, I'm a human being. I'm a flesh and blood dude. I had a mother and a father, and they raised me from when I was born, and I lost my dad 11 years ago, and I just lost my mother not a year ago. I'm still grieving my father, okay? I'm still my father's death. I'm still grieving, all right? It's been over a decade, and I think about him every day, all right? I'm a human being, all right, who has parents. I have children, all right? And I'm in a deep sense of grief every day, all right, over the death of my mother, every day. You see me go, he's grieving the death of his mother, and know that. Says maybe it's the cold climate when some of those people got blood clots after taking the AstraZeneca vaccine. I don't know. I don't know that that's. I don't know that that's a thing. One of the reasons given for taking the vaccine is to protect others. That person is correct in saying that. Is it? I mean, I thought it was just to reduce your chance of getting sick and dying. Good day, Juan. The same way the COVID deaths were exaggerated, so are the side effects. Okay. It says the vaccine is mandatory. They're just not saying it yet because if you don't take it, you can't go anywhere or travel. That's a very real possibility. That is. All right, the vaccine is forced because you won't be able to go anywhere. Try getting rid of the black eye. Yeah. It says, don't mind that person. Why? They have no soul, heart, or compassion. Says most countries are now banning AstraZeneca except one country that keep pumping this evil vaccine into the Bahamas. Okay. I mean, I don't, that's not the case, but okay. Says the Novavax should be very good. All right. Says FDA warning, hand sanitizers from Mexico placed on import alert. Well, brother, I buy my hand sanitizer, right, from John Watlin's up here. It's very good stuff. And then what I do with that is I buy some isopropyl alcohol, and I cut that like in half, and I use the alcohol, because alcohol really is what you want to break down all the COVID and whatever like this. But you know what? There may be some sort of impact from this in years to come about all this hand sanitization too. You never know. You like Johnson & Johnson, but yet they've been sued for the opioid crisis and cancer-causing talcum powder. Now they have a problem with their vaccine in Colorado after their vaccine site closes early after adverse reactions to Johnson & Johnson shot. I saw that in Colorado. Hey, as it stands, I'm on board. That can change. If you get more information, here's part of what being an adult, sentient, responsible human is. If you get more information on a particular topic, you're entitled to change your point of view. Yep. If you're better informed about something, if more information comes out, if something is revealed, you're entitled to change your point of view. As it stands now, I'm prepared to take it. If after millions of doses are administered and they find, hey, this is a problem, then that might change. All right? We got to go? All right. I'll see you guys on Monday. Take care out there, and have a great day, Bahamas.